You're live. Good morning. Welcome to the Therapeutic Conversation Show. I'm your host, Brian Jones, LPC, Dr. Brian Jones. I am so excited to be a part of this wonderful show, and I have my co-host here, Margaret Conley Green. Hey, Margaret. Can you hear me, Margaret? Can you hear me, Margaret?
Hey!
How are you?
I can see you. Hello.
Hi. Yes. Well, we both are remote today, so, you know, we're just excited that...
I'm trying. I got to lean in. I'm going to turn it up just a little.
Okay, well, go ahead and lean in and get yourself all set and ready, okay? But anyway, we are so excited that you all are deciding to join us. Today is Mental Health Awareness Month, the whole month of May. So we're so excited that you all are here. Hopefully, you know, with remote, I'm not in the studio. Margaret's not in the studio today. So we are just here, just really talking about the mental health awareness. That's our main goal, our main thing today. Call in today at 770-988-6461. That's 770-988-6461. We would love to have some comments today. And the question that we're using today is, what are you doing for mental health awareness? You know, and we need to really raise that. And I'm going to read some of the statistics in a few minutes. And we're going to talk about, you know, raising the awareness of mental health. Margaret, you still with me?
I am.
All right. So I want to go ahead and open up with a scripture this morning. And basically, this is a foundational scripture that I do use. It's found in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 2. That's Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 2. And it says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds so that you may discern what is the will of God and what is good, acceptable, and perfect. So I want to highlight verse 2, and I've used this scripture before on here, but it says, do not be conformed to this world. And I read from the New Revised Translation, by the way. But it says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good, acceptable, and perfect. And so basically what I want to lift up from that particular passage is the fact that our minds need to be renewed, number one.
Yes.
There is so much stuff going on. I have watched the news this week. I have watched people do all kinds of things this week. And we have to renew our minds, number one. We have to think different thoughts, think new thoughts, new ways of being in relationship with people, new ways of seeing things differently in a whole different world, in a whole different way. And so that's the first thing. Second thing is, this text says that you cannot even understand the will of God unless you have renewed your mind. You cannot even, and so it deals with our theology. And in psychology, we call it our belief system. It deals with your belief system, what you believe about yourself, what you believe about others, and what you believe about God. So those type of things determine and factor in our behavior and how we function and how we move and how we live and how we have our being. So today we're talking about raising our level of mental health. And there is a, I enjoyed this video this week from the National Alliance on Mental Institution, NAMI. And I enjoyed the part in there where, what's her name, Margaret? The lady that plays on, and I know y'all gonna be sending me messages because I forgot her name, her real name, Cookie. Everybody know that name.
Taraji P. Henson.
Yes, and she did a wonderful video on curing stigma. And she said, this is that mental health is able to be cured as far as the stigma is able to be cured. And I thought that was a wonderful message. All right, so let's just go ahead and get started with a word of blessing and prayer. God, we thank you for this moment and this time. We thank you for 108 Praise Radio and all that's associated here. We thank you for all that you're doing in us, through us, and around us. We thank you that you have just allowed us to connect, even though we're in different locations today. But let the word go out. Let people be blessed. Let people be touched. Let people get the information that they need this day. We thank you for everything that you have done and that you're doing in us, through us, and around us. In your name we pray. Amen. All right.
Amen.
All right, Margaret, what's going on in your week? And what do you have to say about Mental Health Awareness Month, May?
Well, I need to do practice it today. So I was supposed to be in the studio, but y'all see the beautiful glass panes of Northside Psych Hospital. so I think it's good that I'm here, though, because you get to see Dr. Brian doing self-care and you get to see mental health at work for the most part, because a lot of people do not manage their mental health. They kind of get overwhelmed. So this month, you know, I'm going to a conference, and it is a way for me to manage my mental health, because I'm going away from Georgia. Mm-hmm. And I planned that on purpose so that I could focus and breathe. I also love water, so it's on the West Coast.
Ooh.
And so I get to go.
Now, when is this conference, Margaret? When is this conference?
I'm going to a DBT conference. But it's also a way for me to cheat, because I like to ride my bike. I like to do stuff.
They don't know what DBT is.
So it's delectable behavior treatment. So I hope I said that correctly. I always stumble on the D. But it's mindfulness. That's basically the one big word that you can say. And I want to say hello to Joanne. Hey, Kim. Devon. Hey, Gina. And so I invited some people to come on this morning, because I really want them to hear about Mental Health Month and Mental Health Awareness Month. And I also invited someone on. She contacted me this morning and said, I'm interested in you coming to my gym and doing some remote stuff. And so, Brian, there we go. So we got people who want to show different ways of doing self-care in this month. So I told Kimberly Alexander that I would connect with her and see how we could do that, so that we can give people options.
Yes.
Because mental health care does not mean you have to go sit on the couch and cry all the time or put your feelings out. Self-care is a way for you to take care of your body, your mind, and your spirit. And so if we don't manage that and get that done, then, oh my God, we lose ourselves. And so I really like what Taraji said. And also Dwayne Johnson, The Rock.
Yes.
He had one too, and it was really powerful. That they were both speaking. One, they were very open with themselves, you know, and they expressed that they too have to take care of themselves in order to be healthy. And so I think that's something for all communities, where we lose a piece of self, we lose a piece of time, because we get so busy with other people that we do not take care of our mental health. And so this is the month. I put up yesterday on Facebook, you know, and I was joking, but I really meant it. You know, find a couch and sit on it. So if your couch is the gym, if your couch is riding a bike, if your couch is going to the movies, do something to take care of your brain. It's not only healthy, it's holy, because you got to take care of your temple.
Hold on now, Margaret. Did you say taking care of your brain is holy?
Yes.
Wait, hold on now. You know what show this is. This is the therapeutic. So you're trying to say people need to be therapeutic, right? Is that what you're saying? That you don't have to just go to counseling necessarily just to be therapeutic, but you can be therapeutic in your life. Everything about us and everything about the believer's life, the spiritual life, should be holy and also therapeutic. I'm going to use that. I'm going to go ahead and put that in the comments. You go ahead, Margaret.
It's a holy act. You know, and I love the text that you use, and the text that and I've heard, and I've even used it with some of my clients who are Christian, because they always say, you know, I got to do this and do that for God. I got to do this and do this for the church. And I said, you need to renew your mind.
Yeah.
If you don't have a renewed mind, you really don't know what you're supposed to be doing for God.
Yeah.
That's what the text says. So that you can know. The will of God is what the text says, right?
Yes.
And so if you don't have a renewed mind and a renewed self, you don't know your next move for God. You don't know where you're supposed to go. So therefore, you're not operating in holiness. You're just operating in function.
Ooh, hold on now. You got another, what you said, You said operating in what?
So you just operating in function. You're not operating in holiness.
Wow. And so what you're saying is, and you already jumped on this, what you're saying is people are not living in an abundant life because their minds are not renewed.
Right.
That's what you're saying.
That's exactly what you're saying.
And that we're missing out on life because we can't comprehend. You know, there's a text that says, eyes haven't seen, nor have ear heard, nor has entered into the heart of man or woman what God has prepared for those that love them and love God and called according to God's purpose. But we can't even enjoy that because our minds are not clear enough to even understand that concept or to be receptive to all that God has for us. Wow.
Right. Right.
Margaret, we on it. Now I want to look at these statistics, Margaret. I'm pulling my iPad out and I'm looking at these statistics. And I'm so glad that our governor, our wonderful governor of Georgia, Nathan Deal, did a proclamation on the other day dealing with mental health being, you know, the Mental Health Awareness Month in Georgia. Now, what he said in the proclamation is that in Georgia alone, 1.4 million adults in Georgia have been diagnosed with a mental illness. 1.4 million adults in Georgia. Now, nationally, one in every five adults, that's 43.8 million or 18.5% experience mental illness in a given year. One out of every five. Now, what I was thinking about is this, and this is the national statistics, that one in every five experience a mental illness in a given year. That's 43.8 million. And you're telling me that we can't talk about mental health? You're telling me in our spiritual center and churches that we can't address, or we're not, you know, that mental health is not of a priority? It gets even more. The next one says, among the 20.2 million adults who experience a substance use condition, 50.5%, which is 10 million adults, had a co-occurring mental illness. That means out of all of that substance abuse, that 50.5 million people, 10.2 million adults have had illness, but all of it is related back from and showing up in substance abuse. Isn't that something?
That is something. And you know, the big thing about co-occurring is that with co-occurring, because I specialize with co-occurring, and so yes, we look at it as just the use of substance. But when you think about it, you know, what are you addicted to try to make yourself happy because you hadn't renewed your mind? Is it food? Yeah. Is it gambling? Yeah. You know, is it overspending?
Yeah.
I mean, what is it that you have allowed to become a substance to cover up this pain and this hurt?
Yeah.
That can be healed.
Yes.
If you face it and make amends with it, how do we do that so we can lower that number?
Yes. And so, I mean, that is a lot. And then let's look at the youth. One in five ages 13 to 18 experience a severe mental condition at some point in their lives. One in five ages 13 to 18 experience a severe mental health condition at some point in their lives. And then for children 8 to 15, it's 13%. That is a large amount. Let's look at the homeless population. 46% of homeless adults staying in shelters have a mental illness and or substance use disorder. 46% of homeless adults. And I mean, I'm taking time to read this today. I know some of y'all are like, why are you reading the statistics? Because this is where we are. We got to know where we are in order to improve what, you know, what the conditions are. I'm going to read a little bit more. 70% of youth in juvenile justice systems have at least one mental health condition. 70% of youth in juvenile justice systems have at least one mental health condition. I mean, that is a lot. And then even the statistic says African-Americans and Hispanic-Americans use mental health services at half the rate of Caucasian-Americans in the past year. Now, that's a lot. I'm going to stop right there for right now. African Americans and Hispanics use mental health services at about half the rate of Caucasian Americans in a given year. Half.
You know what, Brian? And people always talk about stigma, but I'm gonna put a shameless plug. There are African American therapeutic resources that are now available. There are people of color centered therapeutic resources that are now available.
Wow!
That, like, they're there.
Yeah.
The thing is, so where is the stigma now? Because you're not sitting in front of someone that doesn't look like you.
Wow.
And because of our ethical codes, anybody that's a therapist watching today, y'all know,
yes.
You know, we can't turn you away. We're like, I mean, for lack of a better term, we're like doctors. You said that to me, Brian, you know. you know, we can't let you walk out, but you're saying that you want to do something to yourself. You can get help.
Yeah.
It's there.
Yeah.
And so it's sad that our communities are still trying to find ways to deal. And we picked up drug use. We picked up whatever addiction. We picked up whatever. And shameless to say, because we're talking about therapeutic intervention with theological concept, some of our churches don't even want to invite the professional in. Because of what they think is going to happen.
Yes. Yeah. And that's the truth, because a lot of times, unfortunately, they don't get their own services. Lakeba Wallace, thank you for joining us. I do see you have a comment, and please send your comments on Facebook right now. We are live, even though we're not in the studio. We are live, or you can call in at 770-988-6461. That's 770-988-6461. You can call in or you can send us a message. But Lakeba, thank you for joining us. And she has a comment, Margaret, that says, how do we deal with and address mental health for the youth? Oh my God, and that is
That's loaded. A big one.
That's loaded. First thing I would say, and then I'm gonna let Margaret chime in, is we gotta start educating our youth. But I must say something. Thank you so much for that question, Lakeba. But what I would say first is that we really have to, I did a workshop a few weeks ago dealing with teenagers. And we talked about using spiritual principles to deal with stress and anxiety in high school and college students. And they were much more open to the conversation dealing with mental health than many of the adults are. So I think using social media, I think using different platforms to get the word out there, to normalize, if I can use that term, mental health, to make it an active part of our lives, part of our spiritual lives, part of the way we live, the way we see, the way we move, and the way we have our being. And I think breaking that stigma with them is, in my opinion, Margaret, I don't know your opinion, sometimes can be a little easier than dealing with some of these adults.
Yes. Yes, it can. So I have a friend, Ms. Ann Dillard, who all she does, and she says it very loud and proud, is work with young females.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't really dabble in adulthood because she knows that that whatever trauma or whatever thing has happened,
mm-hmm.
They're willing and receptive to seek change.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think the way to start with our youth, I love how she thinks. So
yeah.
I think the way to start with our youth is be open with them to change. Society has changed.
Yes.
Platforms have changed. I mean, look at us today, Brian. I promise you, 20 years ago, I wouldn't have thought that I would have did a split screen.
I wouldn't have thought that either.
We talked about this. So there are different avenues to work with our youth. Telemental health and telehealth period is becoming a very big thing. And so some of that thing we call stigma, you can get services from the privacy of your home on your own couch, on your phone. So if that's what you like to do, that there are different spaces, BetterHelp, Talkspace. And then with youth, engage them where they are. That's huge. Hot dogs, hamburgers, and Kool-Aid are not 2018. We've got to engage youth where they are. It might require you to listen to a Nicki Minaj album or Cardi B's new album yes. to understand why they saying stuff to you that doesn't make any sense. It may yes. require you to step out of your box,
yes.
but reach them so that they can see you are touching them where they are. And not only does that help them with their mental health, it starts to engage them in community.
Yes.
I'm really big on communal mental health. If our communities yes. aren't healed, yes. it doesn't matter how many people we think or walking around, our community needs to be healed as well.
Yes, yes. And I think that that's a part of it. And I also think, you know, I was thinking this the other day about Vacation Bible School and all of those type of things, which are wonderful programs that I grew up on. And I know a lot of churches are still having that. But why not have a mental health component in your Vacation Bible School? You ever yes. thought about that? You know, because everybody, you know, is still doing that. I mean, not everybody, but a lot of churches are still doing that. But have some kind of educational program and everything in your church to talk about mental health. I'm ready to do a program at a local church here in Atlanta that I'm so excited about. It's a clinical pastor education program. And then it's also going to have each month for the next 4 to 5 months a mental health workshop. We're going to be talking about depression and anxiety. You know, we're going to be addressing how to care for loved ones during that loss and grief. We're going to be talking about the trauma recovery. We're going to be talking about drug and substance abuse in the church. Abuse period in the church, domestic violence in the church, you know, and in our communities. Uh-huh. Amen. I'm gonna let that sink in. But anyway, but you know, we're gonna be talking about that and dealing with that, and then we're gonna have a support group where people, an open group that's gonna be free, that people can come and talk about their challenges, talk about their issues, talk about what they're experiencing, talk about how they're feeling, what's going on and what's happening. So it's, I mean, those are things that can be done, incorporated into spiritual and religious communities. I mean, think about it. What is the largest gathering, you know, and I'm speaking from the African-American context, of people gathering together? It would be on a Sunday. And that's what I also want to do. I want to encourage a lot of, you know, the religious leaders, pastors, ministers that are speaking and preaching this month, please say something about mental yeah. health. I mean, this is Mental Health Awareness Month. If you don't say nothing but this is Mental Health Awareness Month and I'm on board, people, you don't know what that would do for people. And explain to people, this is Mental Health Awareness Month and we're raising awareness that that is part of your spiritual, you know, your whole spiritual being. Your mind is part of your spiritual development. And that's what we're talking about on this show. That's why we have this show. So please call in 770-988-6461. Or you can also send us a message on Facebook. I do see Dr. Marlo Mathis has joined us. All right. Send a message. I mean, there's 4, 5, or 6, or 8 other people on. I think there's more than that on. Send a little message so we'll know you're here. Send a comment. Send something that you would like to say or that you would like to add to the conversation, because this is a conversation and we're not the only people that have the answers and have the words. All right. But anyway, I just want to encourage you all, please, you know, this is Mental Health Awareness Month. Please reach yes. out. Please talk about it. Please share it. These statistics, 1 in every 5. I've already read the statistics. 43.8 million people experience a mental illness in a given year. In 1 year. I mean, and so, and guess what? With all this system, and I've said this several weeks now, with all the system changes that we're having, governmental changes, funding being cut, people are going to start coming to spiritual centers and churches in droves, I believe, looking for answers, looking for support. And they're looking for more than just to be preached at. Am I in trouble by saying that?
I don't think so, because I might get in trouble for this. I think, and with that influx, because people are seeking home. They're seeking community. They see this hurt. You know, the Bible is really clear on this one thing. I quote this all the time. You know, we don't have a spirit of fear. Mm. So the stigma and the things, that lets me know that it can be broken. Mm. But we walk in power and love and a sound mind.
Yes.
I think it's people of color. we are really big on that power piece right now.
Yes.
Like we are marching and we are ranting and we are doing what we need to do to be heard.
Yes.
And that might be out of the love that we have for our community and the love we have for self.
Yes.
But the sound mind piece, that is the piece that's that emotional wellness that we need to care for. And how do we get that? Because now we are seeing where our youth, I don't know if everybody remembers, but March 14th, we had a 11-year-old female of color that stood up and said, I now have to take care of myself because nobody will stand for me. And don't think that I don't realize that in 7 years, I'll be the one voting. That was that I was stuck on her comment.
Wow.
Because that community piece. So we have power. I even believe we have love. It's some places of love that still need some work. But I think that comes with care. Mm. But that sound mind.
Yes.
We are everywhere right now.
Yes. Yes.
And so how do we bring that together? And I think it goes back to Romans 12, 2.
Yeah.
We have to have a renewed mind to have a sound mind.
Yes. And we're on the same page, Margaret, because that's where we are right now. I mean, that is where we are. And I think that that is the key to change when we transform our minds and deal with our minds and deal with our minds also help us. And I want to definitely give my prayers and thoughts to the theological community for the transition of the wonderful, great James Cone.
Yes.
Black
father liberation. Of black theology. Oh my God.
And black liberation theology. I've never met James Cone, but I've read his books. I just finished my doctoral program. I've used his materials in my doctoral program. I'm so thankful in my life for Virginia Union University, the Samuel DeWitt Proctor School of Theology at Virginia Union, where I was theologically trained. And we use James Cone stuff every day there. And it was a blessing to look at things from a different lens. And what I feel like, you know, just honoring his life and his powerful work. And I don't even know other words to describe his work. But to look at things from a different lens and also to accept us for who we are and not be ashamed to claim all of us, all the things
all
that, you know, deal with, you know, that we haven't claimed in the past. I'm going to put it like that. Things that we haven't spoke up for and haven't, you know, but we can stand in our identity, stand in our, you know, being authentic. We can stand in knowing that God is the God of the oppressed. And I mean, that is a powerful statement, and probably we'll have something down the road. Definitely just honoring James Cone and his powerful work and his service to the theological community, to the church, and to the world, international world. I mean, just powerful. But if you think about it, it's time. We really need to start dealing with this. One in every five persons experience a mental health illness in a given year. And what another part, too, I want to highlight is that youth part again. Many people are bringing their especially mothers. I want to give a shout out today to the mothers that are bringing their children in to counseling. They don't know exactly what's going on a lot of times with their children, especially their male children. They're bringing them into my practice, I mean, in droves, and just trying to say, please talk to my son. I'm just trying to help him. I'm trying to support him. I'm trying to give him love and support, and I see something is just not right. Would you at least assess him, talk to him? And I just want to give a shout out today to those diligent mothers that are reaching out and doing the work and bringing their children in to that. I think it's an awesome thing. It's an awesome way of looking at it. So I just, you know, shout out. But I want to see some more comments. You can call us. Dr. Marlowe, you still on? You can give us a call. I know you work with the youth and in the community, in a community agency, you can have your own practice. And I know you are on once a month with me. If you have a comment, I do see that you're on 770-988-6461, or people can still send a comment on Facebook, and I'm looking at the comments. Any comments you have, Margaret? Anybody saying anything?
We're talking about parents bringing their children in. I'm very thankful for Lakeeba. Thank you for saying that. And I'm glad, you know, I like how Spirit works, like how this conversation has turned into talking about our youth. So our youth are literally the most important part of our legacy.
Mm-hmm.
Because they are the next, and they're, yes, not even the next. They're the right now. They're making the statement. They're making the movement. They're putting the traffic out. And I've read Cone. I actually got to meet him one time. And,
oh, wow.
And it was at his lecture about the cross and the lynching tree, which was his, I want to say it was his latest work that was published that, mm-hmm, I'm aware of. If not, mm-hmm, that can be corrected. But that he spoke to that.
Mm.
And he spoke about him and his youth listening to the stories of his parents and watching his parents, mm-hmm, and their struggle and remembering what was ahead of them. Lynching trees, like they didn't know from day to day if they were going to make it home. I mean, like literally. So here we are in 2018 with the same issue and the same conversation, especially for our Black males. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I'm going to make it home. You know, and Brian, and for every Black male watching, that is a truth. You don't know if when you walk outside, you're going to make it home, no matter, mm, what the lynching tree is now, no matter, and James Cone compared it to a cross, no matter what, mm, this cross is now that we bear, we don't know if we're going to make it home. So what do we do with that? And I was reading a statistic, mm, from Rollout Magazine that was talking about our youth and the increase of suicidal attempts and suicidal ideations among African-American young males, mm-hmm, and it's 1 in 4.
Wait, hold on now. So that's a new statistic that I hadn't seen.
Yeah, that's a new statistic in Rollout Magazine. I saw it. This article about a week ago.
All right, 1 in every 4 what? Say that again.
1 in every 4 African-American males between the ages of 14 to 21 have thought about or contemplated or attempted suicide.
Wait, hold on. We got to sit with that. That's a lot. That is a lot.
That's a lot.
And the numbers have to be increasing.
That's a lot. And so what are we doing? And again, thank you, Lakeeba. What are we doing not just for our youth, but what are we doing for our Black male youth? Because I think males of color, mm, are in this... They're in this tough, rough spot,
mm,
and I think our young males are really in a rough spot.
Yes,
and yes, sometimes we don't address it because we want to cover it in a blanket. But the truth be told, I would imagine, because I'm not a male, I would imagine that our young men,
oh yes,
and our men have different sets and psyche right now of frustration and anxiety and depression,
yes,
because they don't know if they're going to make it home.
Yes. Yes. And there are people that, you know, that live like this every day, Margaret, you know, that we know, and it's a struggle. And I mean, I have seen, and I'm only speaking from an African-American male perspective here, and I'm not, you know, downing anybody else, but I do think that, you know, it's not easy. It's not easy being a human being, I think, on this planet sometimes, but,
yeah,
but being an African-American male myself and just seeing some of the challenges with the police, even myself, I mean, I'm educated, highly educated, you know, but yet when I see police myself, sometimes it sends me into a traumatic trauma type situation, wow, because I don't know whether I'm going to end up, you know, experiencing something like that. I mean, you know, and so I don't think it has to do with just education. I think it has to do with just, you know, what's been put out in the media, what we see, the videos that we've seen of women too being abused, men being abused by police. And, you know, and it's just a lot of pressure put on, you know, everyone. But speaking from an African-American perspective, and I'm just thinking about my growing up, you know, if it wasn't for the church, it wasn't for a group of people, and I can start naming them. I don't have time to name them, but just the people that I grew, you know, that really spoke into my life and said, Brian, you're not going to be this way. You're going to go to school. You're going to make something of your life. You're going to do something. And they kept on saying this, even though I didn't want to hear it. You know, I'm like, no, But see, what I'm seeing though, Margaret, I think you're onto something. There's a lot of anger. That's what I'm seeing that stem. And there's a lot of anger and there's a lot of disconnection. A lot of African-American males are emotionally, that's what I talk about in my practice when I'm working with clients, we're emotionally disconnected. So we can't, so we're taught to be numb and can't feel, but the behavior that we display a lot of times is through destructive actions, secret lies, and alcohol and substance abuse, and all this, you know, and I can go down the list of things that we all, you know, have our own vices that we get caught up in that are a lot of times abusive and destructive to ourselves and also sometimes to other people. And so I'm seeing this whole rage, that's what it's called, rage and anger that, you know, and then a disregard for your own value of your own self. And if you don't value yourself, how can you value someone else? If you don't love yourself, how can you love someone else? But it is a self-hatred. That's what I'm seeing for yourself as well as other people in the community, that people are, you know, and they're just going through and you know, just magnifying that out, you know, because they don't appreciate or understand or connect it to themselves. And I think that's the issue a lot of times. And I mean, definitely we're going to have a show and talk more about it on one of the shows, but it's definitely, you know, a challenge. So I'm glad that, you know, people are bringing that up. All right, you can still call in. It's still time, 770-988-6461. We would love to have a comment. If you want to send a message on Facebook, you can send us a message on Facebook. It's 108 Praise Radio, the app. You can look at the that on Facebook and send us a wonderful comment. We are having just a conversation. I know it's a little different today because we're not in the studio, but we are talking about something that's serious. We're raising the bar for Mental Health Awareness Month, being May. We talked about the proclamation that Nathan Deal put out and basically stating that 1.4 million adults in Georgia have been diagnosed with a mental illness. And my question today is what you're going to do about it, which, you know, and I want to hear some comments. What are you all going to do about it? Everybody complain and talk and say this ain't being done and the youth are doing this and the youth are doing that. What are we going to do about it? What you are going to personal responsibility, what are we going to do? Now, I have some suggestions, Margaret. I know you probably have some, too. First thing is, I want everyone needs to begin to support the mental health agencies that are out there. That's one thing I thought about. Supporting the mental health agencies that are out there. You know, and also some of the organizations, the ACA, which is the American Counseling Association. Also, in Georgia, we have the LPCA of Georgia, you know, NAMI, N-A-M-I, you can look up those, the National Alliance for, you know, Mental, you know, Institution or something. I mean, but NAMI, you can look up that, you can get trained there as peer support counselors. They have all kinds of free information and things like that. I have my own nonprofit, the Foundation for Therapeutic and Spiritual Empowerment Services, which is the 501c3. And that's the second point. Not just get the information from these places, but also donate. You can donate your money. $20 goes a long ways toward counseling. And that's what we're doing here at the Joshua Generation. We are providing, trying to provide affordable, but also free counseling for people that cannot afford it. And therefore, if you give to our foundation, you can look us up on Facebook, the Foundation for Therapeutic and Spiritual Empowerment Services. I'll put it in the comments in a few minutes. And you can look us up and you can donate right online, or you can go to any Bank of America and just say, I would like to donate to the Foundation for Therapeutic and Spiritual Empowerment Services. And you can give your donation, 20, 30, 40, 50, 20,000, whatever you want to give. Just to help somebody, you know, because maybe you don't need the services, but you know somebody in your family, somebody in your community, somebody in. And so the last point that I would say is we have to listen to each other. We have to listen to what people are saying, but also what people are not saying. And I think we got to really begin to emphasize that part about listening. People are saying all kinds of things, and sometimes we're ignoring them, or we're going, oh, that's just Johnny over there, or that's just Susan over there, or that's just so-and-so over there, and that's how they are. But we don't sit and listen to each other and support one another. Tim, thank you for joining us. Tim Daniels.
Hey, Tim.
Yes, yeah, he's going today. And Eunice, thank you for joining us and everything. And, you know, but I'm just saying it's just awesome that we're having this conversation about it. What's your recommendations about what other people can do, and then we want to talk about what we're doing.
So this is, you know, this is what you can do. I want to mention the NASW for social workers, and also for families, marriage family therapy counselors uh-huh. are absolutely phenomenal. So uh-huh. you know, you have LPCs and LCSWs uh-huh. and people who they may uh-huh. focus on individual. But marriage family therapy counselors, they literally focus on family and how to redirect family. Mm-hmm. And I said that carefully, because then nobody in our profession is in the place of fixing. Mm-hmm. We want to show you pathways of health, and mm-hmm. so especially emotional health. The other thing is find that thing that brings you joy and do it this month. Yes. Don't make excuses about that.
Yes.
If riding a bike brings you joy, find the time to ride your bike and feel good. Give yourself permission to feel good. Give yourself permission to be holy in your emotional wellness. Do that and give yourself permission to do it. Give yourself permission to tell yourself you're beautiful, you're awesome, you're amazing. Give yourself permission to say that you are the best you. And I think a lot of times we don't say those affirmations over ourselves. We don't speak good over ourselves. We find all the negative pieces, but that renewed mind will show you the will of God, and the will of God for you is good and pleasant.
Oh, wow.
If I remember correctly, I have good things in store for you. You don't even know is what the word says. You don't even know what is in store for you.
Yes.
But every good and perfect gift comes from God. So speak those blessings. Give yourself permission to do that. And then I would absolutely recommend that you find that professional, someone that you trust, and go sit with them.
Yes.
And give yourself permission to tell your story, no matter what that story sounds like. Give yourself permission to tell your story so that you can hear your story in a healthy and holy way.
Yes.
So, you know, those are things that open up that space to heal, especially in traumatic situations. We replay. Post-trauma. We just replay it. It looks like a movie until we find ways to not replay that anymore, but to move on to our next chapter and into those spaces that God has called us into.
Yes, and that is so vital, and I think that is so powerful. So there's workshops going on. Margaret's going to be doing some groups. I'm going to be doing some groups. Definitely look out on our Facebook page for things from the foundation. I just sent that out. Also be, you know, the Joshua Generation Care and Consulting Services. You can Google us, and definitely you can get information there. If you have any questions too, you can also email us at admin@joshua-generation.net. That's admin, A-D-M-I-N, at joshua-generation.net, and we'll get your email and we'll be able to kind of communicate and talk. But we're raising mental health awareness this month. This is Mental Health Awareness Month, and we're curing the stigma of mental health. And that's all this show is about. We're talking about our spirituality. We're talking about mental health, our spirituality, and also empowerment. And this is all we're talking about, you know, a lot of times on this show. And hopefully, and I just want to say, you know, before we go today, thank you all so much for all your comments, all your questions. All, you know, just the things that people are listening to. I'm looking at the numbers, and people are watching this during the week or sharing it. You know, continue to just support this. Continue to support it in your prayers, but as well as financially, because the cost to be on the air, you know, and if, you know, we'd love to receive any gifts of love, you know, of help, of support.
Yes.
And also invite us to your churches, to your places, so we can help. We're not here to bash churches for not doing mental health. We're here to assist churches and spiritual centers and the community so we can raise awareness in dealing with mental health. So we're so excited. We're thankful to 108 Praise Radio. We're thankful to Margaret today for being my co-host and for all that she's sharing. I know she has a few comments and things like that. And I'm just excited to be here and to be doing this type of work. But if you don't get anything else out of this program, your takeaway is this. Please know that you matter and that God loves you and that we have to deal with, you got to start dealing with your mental health. A lot of people out there watching this show, you know you need to get services. You know you need to get with someone who's licensed and trained and certified to offer support to you. And that's the goal. And you may know somebody else. Encourage them to get services, to go at least for one visit, to try to get services, to be a better person, to be all that they can be. And I like that holy part, that a holy mind is a therapeutic mind. You know, things like that are just, but try to be therapeutic in everything that we do. We're not perfect, but everything that we do, our intentions should be therapeutic. So that's all I have to say about that. Margaret, you know, your comments before we go today.
So, I am trying to, I would like to, I know in June I'm going to start doing a men to be resilient, resiliency groups. And so, I just want to pitch that. I'm going to do it in my home area of Cartersville.
Wonderful.
I'm currently looking for space. So, but we have to find a way to be resilient.
Yeah.
Because we have relived and relived and relived and relived. That's all I can say, our trauma.
Yeah.
And we sometimes seek out people to be able to do something that they cannot do.
Yeah.
They can't, whether they have passed away or whether they're alive and they too are numb to the situation.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have to find a way to make amends.
Yeah.
And my personal belief is you can't mend everything.
Mm.
We didn't stop Judas from killing Jesus. But how do we make amends with the cross? Is that we walk in our salvation and know that the blood still works.
Wow.
And so we couldn't stop Judas, but Judas made a way for everyone to have this freedom of abundant life connected to Christ. And so I hope we take that away with our personal lives. That sometimes we can't mend things that have happened, but we can find a way to make amends and move forward in our best selves and who God called us to be. And so that's my encouragement. And so those groups will start, I know, definitely in June. If I can start them in May, I'll let you guys know. You can follow. You can also look it up on my website. Keep following me, www.mendinglifeconcepts.com. Also look at me. I will soon be on Dr. Brian's website.
Yes, you will.
I fixed my bio. And I want you to know I'm connected to Joshua Generation. And so please, please, please know that you can connect. Just look them up. Psychology Today, Google.
Yes.
Find a way. And if you're too afraid to go out and go to somebody's office, Talkspace, Better Health, and several ones that you can actually do it on your phone. But please, please, please take this mom to just be aware and be aware of your emotional wellness and your value and how wonderful you are.
Wonderful. Oh, that's a wonderful way to end. And think about it, that you're valuable and that you deserve it and that you're worth it. And that's therapeutic, isn't that? You know, and I just think that we got to be helping people to say therapeutic things to ourselves. A lot of times we beat up ourselves. We're our worst enemies. And we beat up, you know, by our words. And our words come from our thought process. And we just constantly say negative words over ourselves. But why don't we sometimes change that and start speaking positive words? I can do this. I can, you know, be healthy. I can be in a healthy relationship. I could just be a good person.
Yes.
You know, using affirmations like that can be so therapeutic. So that's what we're talking about on this show. This is the Therapeutic Conversation Show. I'm your host, Dr. Brian Jones. I'm joined here with Margaret Conley Green. We're so excited that she is on and she's coming on. We'll be coming on more, sharing things. And we're going to be talking about all kinds of things. So we're just so excited for this platform. Even as we close, just continue to reach out. You can reach out to me on you know, our website, www.joshua-generation.net. I also put in there the Foundation for Therapeutic and Spiritual Empowerment Services, which is a 501c3. Please donate, please share, please send information, questions to admin@joshua-generation.net. You can check us out there. Thank you so much for joining us today. This is Mental Health Awareness Month, and we're raising the awareness of mental health. We're helping people and we're breaking those barriers and those silence, you know, that silence, that quietness that people don't really want to talk about. But we're breaking these stigmas of mental health this week, and not, I mean, this month, but the whole year. But we're really highlighting mental health awareness this month and really talking about the need for awareness. We got to be aware, we got to be educated, and make sure that you get yourself educated more and more. The more you know about your mental health, the more you'll know about your life and the better person that you can be for such a time as this. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your comments. Dr. Marlowe, thank you for joining us. Tim, thank you for joining us. There's so many other people. Lakiba, thank you for joining us. Anybody on your end that we want to thank before we go?
Hey, Aisha, thank you for joining us.
Yeah.
And to all the people who did join, thank you guys for making this a success. Please keep supporting Dr. Brian Jones as he is doing great work.
Thank you.
Not only in the metro area, but he's doing great work all over the world because yes. He doesn't brag about who he's all connected to. So,
and Dr. Hale joined us too.
Thank you
for joining us. Yeah, so we're just excited and we're thankful for such a time as this. Have a wonderful week. We'll see you again next week. This is the Therapeutic Conversation Show. I'm your host, Dr. Brian Jones, in the house with Margaret Conley Green. Thank you, Margaret, for your time and for the power of technology. We don't know whether they heard
yes.
but somebody heard something because they were commenting. And so the power of technology makes this week a therapeutic week. Good quote right there. Make this week a therapeutic week for yourself. Be encouraged and be blessed.
Right now, I'm standing here with Robert Hawkins, who we just heard a few minutes ago, all the way from Grand Rapids, Michigan. Now, Robert, this isn't your first time on the Word Network. You started singing background. So how does it feel to be at the front of the stage?
I counted a joy for what God is doing. God has been amazing. So it's just a blessing and an honor to be able to serve Him. Excuse me.
Absolutely. Now, your single is titled Happy.
Yes.
And happy means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. Mm-hmm. So tell us what it means to you.
It means everything to me because you're looking at a miracle. Hallelujah. You're looking at someone that struggled and battled with drug addiction for 6 years, 18 months ago. Hallelujah. Crack cocaine.
Thank you, Jesus.
And I wasn't happy. I didn't understand happiness. I didn't understand joy. I didn't understand peace. All I knew was just bondage, defeat. But I stand here today free from drug addiction, 18 months. I'm truly happy today. The joy of the Lord is my strength. That's why I jump, I dance, I shout. Because if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I knew I wouldn't be here on the Word Network tonight. I probably would have been dead, somewhere sleeping in my grave. Y'all would have been coming to my funeral. But God saw fit. I love Him.
So we want you to go ahead and sing happy for us.
Come on, let me see you clap your hands.